Okay. So welcome everybody to the first monthly Colloquium series talks that we have started now. It's a great pleasure to have Professor Narlikar actually start this series. It's a privilege for me to introduce him. Professor Narlikar, he was of course an extremely well-known scientist, so I think all of you probably know everything I'm going to say. But in any case, let me repeat a few of the things. He got his BA and his PhD from Cambridge University in mathematics, but specializing in astronomy and astrophysics. He's very well known for the work that he did in Cambridge with Hoyle on Hoyle-Narlikar theory, the quasi-steady-state theory. That is the alternative explanation for Big Bang theory, and he has worked not just on that topic but on a whole variety of topics in astronomy and astrophysics related to black holes, quasars, quantum cosmology, action at a distance, and many other topics. He has received a lot of awards, which I won't start listing. The first which that comes to my mind well before I was born was in 1965, the Padma Bhushan, then Padma Vibhushan in 2004. He's very well known as a scientific communicator, for which he received the Kalinga Prize of UNESCO in 96. So I think I just mentioned a few of the many different awards that he has received for his contributions to science in general. I guess most of us probably have a story of hearing him through many different science communication channels that he has been very actively participating in. For me, I remember the Surabhi program on TV, for sure, apart from many books, fiction and non-fiction books that I read while growing up. So it's a great privilege to have him here give the colloquium, Professor Narlikar.
Okay, friends, I am very happy to visit here. This is my first visit, and I would like to thank my hosts for the warm hospitality. I want to talk about this particular topic, which is the question mark, how well do we know our universe? Now you will find, if you look up ancient literature, that it is every civilization has its own group of wise men who claim to know what the universe is like, although those ideas may change from time to time. So first let us go back in time and look at the history of how things were looked at. So the question receives this particular answer very well. That means we understand the universe very well. And this answer is given by most human cultures at all epochs. That is very important. So this definitive and positive answer is usually given. So just to look at some of the ancient ideas, we have our own Indian concept of Brahmand, or the cosmic egg. This is, here you see an artist's impression that an egg has been broken open, and inside the whole universe was there, that has come out. So that egg is containing the universe, and that is what we call this Brahmand. Then we go further. Looking at the Nordic civilization, the Norse world tree, this was a concept that the whole universe is suspended or born by the tree which is shown here. So this tree has branches as well as roots which contain the different components of the universe. So the tree is carrying everything. This was the concept from Northern Europe. Then we can come to our own hierarchical model, where you see that the earth is carried by four elephants who stand on a, as you see here, this structure, and this at the bottom of it is a snake which is eating its own tail. So all this thing is a hierarchical structure, one on top of the other, and this was considered the real answer to what the universe is like. Okay, let's go further. Then we made some progress, and in the old days, as I was describing, you had various kinds of pictures, but no proof that this is actually the case. As I said, there were some wise men, so those wise men told that this is how the universe is, and we accept it. Here, when the Greeks began to show their approach in terms of what we would consider science today, the emphasis was that whatever you claim to say, that particular thing has to be proved by experiments or observations. There has to be some proof. You can't get away with just saying it is like this or that. So these Pythagoreans were a kind of cult which grew out of Pythagoras' students or pupils. So these they had their own idea of what the solar system is like. And the idea was like this, that there is a central fire, here you see, and that central fire has the earth going round in a circle, and you ask, where is the sun in the whole picture? So the answer is, the sun is up and down here. It is not at the center of the Earth's orbit. So when they made this particular claim, they were asked for proof, as you would in a scientific theory. So what they said was that, they were asked, where is the central fire? Why don't we see it? So their argument was that this is the Earth going around the central fire, but there is a counter Earth which also goes around the central fire, which always hides the Earth from the central fire. So it is synchronized to move as if it wants to block. So this satisfied the critics for a while, but then they came back with the question, why don't we see the counter Earth if it is near us and is moving with us? So they said, look, Greece is facing the opposite way, so that is why you don't see. Okay. Now, this particular example I will refer to towards the end of my talk. I'm just making a statement here. Okay, so this is what we are hoping the subject would develop into. So all statements must be testable and accepted only if checked by observations. Now in Greece, there were three A's, namely Aristarchus, Aristotle, and Archimedes, and of which Archimedes was more practical and down to earth. Aristarchus has the correct idea that heliocentric theory is what he was supporting. But when he was asked to prove that the Earth moves, he said that if you look at the stars in the neighborhood, that is not very far away, and look at them at different times, you should see slight changes in the difference in the direction of that star. And then they were asked how much change in the direction. So he estimated some answer and gave. Now this, in estimating that, he assumed the stars were quite closer than what they are actually. And so he got an answer which was rather large. And people did not find that kind of change of direction. And so they felt that Aristarchus was wrong. And the Earth actually is stationary, doesn't move. That was long back. If you go to Greece, Aristarchus of Samos, so go to Samos, there is a statue of Aristarchus. And underneath is written that Copernicus got the same answer some 1700 years later. So they wanted to make sure that priority is respected. So now let's go. So the decreasing importance of man on the Earth has been the characteristic thing. That is, people wanted man to be dominant person, dominant entity in the whole universe. So Copernicus repeated Aristarchus's claim, and Galileo also supported him very strongly. And he was asked, by the way, by the Pope's examiners who were looking into Galileo's claim, and those examiners asked him, what is your proof that the Earth is stationary, Earth is not stationary and it goes round? So he did not really have the correct answer. What he said was that if you take a glass of water like this and walk with it, the water will jump out of the thing because of instability and so on. So that, look at the, he gave the comparison of this with the situation, the tides in the oceans. The water jumps up and down. He said this is doing it because the Earth is moving. If it were stationary, this would not have moved. Of course, in those days, law of gravitation and tidal interpretation of that whole thing was different. So people did not have the law of gravitation to understand. So people who were examining him and had asked him this question, they were not interested in the answer. They just asked for form's sake and noted down whatever he wrote. But they didn't argue or say that you are wrong or right or whatever it is, because they wanted to ultimately get him to say that he was wrong. Okay, so when this happened, there was the next sort of step here. The man still had consolation that his son was the center of the Milky Way. That is, he identified himself first with the Earth, and when the Earth was not proved to be very important, he got the sun and said that this is my son, S-U-N, by the way. This is my son, and I am an important my member of the universe, because my sun is at the center of the Milky Way, the distribution of stars. So this was his argument. And this is the map of the Milky Way, which Herschel, a distinguished active astronomer in the 18th century, he made this map. And as you see here, this is the center of the Earth, a center of the Milky Way. This is the Milky Way is shown here. And it is as this is all as drawn by Herschel. And he had this center of the Milky Way. So that was good enough for human ego, that our Earth is at the center of the galaxy, but not for very long. Herschel's map of this thing, by the end, by 20th century, early 20th century, it was realized that the sun is two-thirds of the way towards the boundary of the Milky Way. The sun is not at the center, but is on the periphery, as it were. So here is the map of the Milky Way as later on built up. You see here, the sun is about from center to, it's about two-thirds of the way out. So it is not at the center of the galaxy, as they were hoping to show, but different. So this also was a further, what you call, step down for man. So let's go further. Then the majority view was that, okay, let us not worry too much about the sun being not so important. It is our whole, our galaxy. That is ours and that is important. How important it is? So he said the majority view was that our galaxy is the only one that we see. Through the telescope, they saw some faint things. They said that those are nebulae, nebulous things or nebulae, which are part of our galaxy. There were some people in the minority who argued that these are not what you would call distant, and not part of our galaxy, but they are very far away. That is why they look small, and they look faint, but they are galaxies in our own right. But this was not accepted by the majority of astronomers as late as beginning of 20th century. So you see here nebulae of different kinds. And it was argued that all these were part of our galaxy. Now today, if you ask an astronomer, he will tell you that he will tell you that this is part of our galaxy. This is part of our galaxy, but this is not. This is Andromeda Nebula, which is actually a galaxy like our own, in fact, slightly bigger than ours, and well outside it. So all these things would tell us that our galaxy is not the only one, okay? So at that time when this discussion and controversy was going on, with the minority people saying that there are other galaxies which we are seeing in our telescope, and majority saying what is written here, the question whether nebulae are external galaxies hardly any longer needs discussion. This lady says it is all proved that they are not other outer galaxies. It has been answered by the progress of research. No competent thinker with the whole of the available evidence before him can now, it is safe to say, maintain any single nebula to be a star system of coordinate rank with the Milky Way. So this lady, who was a very good popular science writer, she wrote about astronomy and made this particular comment, which you see in 1905. So when this happened, of course, for a while, people continued that this is right. But later, you see, with majority view, that turned out to be wrong. That it means that most of the galaxy, most of the little faint things we see are galaxies in their own right, outside our own. So here you see, what they say. Some nebulae are in the Milky Way, but the majority are outside it. And these are galaxies like the Milky Way. So I want to show you how people at each stage had been very categorically certain of knowing what the reality was. And then subsequently they have been proved to be wrong. So the real revolution that came next was in 1917, Albert Einstein applied the general theory of relativity to model the whole universe. And he expected the universe to be static, but could not get such a model out of his equations. So he revised the theory to include a new force of repulsion so that he could balance attraction with repulsion and produce a theory which is of a static universe. So this force was of the form lambda times distance, where lambda is a constant called the cosmological constant. So this was the next thing that came out, and Einstein also fell into the trap, in a sense, to think that the galaxies that are being seen are all stationary and the universe is static. And he so much trusted this observational conclusion that he was prepared to revise his theory and have this have a cosmological constant in order to make a static solution. But later, in 1929, Hubble found in his famous relation V equal to H times D, that is the standard Hubble law, velocity of recession of a galaxy is a constant times this is equal to constant times the distance d of the galaxy. So the farther the galaxy, the farther is the faster is the motion away from us. So by the way, I should tell you that Abbé Lemaître, who was a Belgian priest, but also mathematician, he solved Einstein's equations, and he found that there are expanding universe solutions available, and he proved, he actually writes the paper in which he gives the value of H, which is fairly close to what Hubble found later. So what I'm saying is this, in 1922, there was Friedman who predicted the expanding universe. He first got the solutions in which galaxies are moving away from us. And this was 1922. He sent his solution to Einstein for comment. But there is not any significant feedback given by Einstein, probably because Einstein believed the universe is static anyway, so such solutions are mathematically interesting, but not necessarily correct. So then we come to 1929, Hubble found this particular relation. Here you see the kind of data that Hubble had was, you had left-hand side here. These are images of galaxies. And you see this is bigger than this, is bigger than this, and also brighter than those down. So indication is that these are, as you go down, you are encountering more and more remote galaxies. And this is the spectral shift, which via Doppler effect tells us how much is the velocity of precession. So you see, therefore, that this whole thing fits with the Hubble law. Now, I once went to the observatory in Liège, where Lemaître used to work. And they have one window in which they have stuck paper by Lemaître of 1927. So you see here, Hubble got in the Hubble's law in 1929. And Lemaître had not only got expanding solutions, but he also predicted what expected velocity distance relation would be like. So, of course, he wouldn't call it by H because Hubble was still in the future. So one could now come to the explanation of expanding universe. The way theory anticipated observations in this case is a strong plus point of the whole picture. If you look at modern cosmology, you can say we are having a situation here that the theoretical prediction came before observational verification, which is the right order. So you are not kind of being post-dicting, but you are doing the right prediction. So Einstein at that time was for dropping lambda, as a static universe was no longer needed. And Friedman's models, with or without lambda, gave a wide range of models anyway. So you see here all theoretical curves which describe how this S of t is the scale factor which tells you how this universe is expanding, and time is on the right-hand side. So most of the interesting models are those which are coming out of the zero, that is t equal to zero, S was zero. These solutions were considered the most important one. And they say that the universe started with a big bang, that is the big explosion, which started this thing. There was nothing before. So Abbé Lemaître had, of course, got there in his paper, and he called it primeval atom. And the name Big Bang was given by Fred Hoyle, who in fact was describing it in a kind of derogatory fashion, that this is this kind of universe. In this context, I would like to mention around 30 years ago, there was a competition organized by, I think, Sky and Telescope, a popular astronomy magazine, in which they asked the readers to propose some other name than Big Bang. If you think Big Bang is not serious enough name for this model, you tell what it should be. So people gave different answers, and the magazine finally came out with the conclusion that Big Bang is the right is the one which most prefer. So Hoyle was saying to me at that time when this came, that they should have given him the prize money for predicting the correct name. Okay. Then we go next. Yeah. So what is Big Bang? It is infinitely dense, infinitely in hot state of the universe when it had no well-defined space-time geometry. Mathematicians would call it a singular epoch, and physicists have been attempting to go as close to this epoch as possible. A beginning was made by George Gamow in looking at early universe. And you see here the abundances of nuclear, nuclear matter, which is made up of small number of particles. So you have light nuclei. So you see here the abundance is described in terms of the density of present density of matter in the universe, and it tells you that the different helium-4, helium-3, hydrogen, deuterium, and so forth. So now this deuterium is the important one. It tells you that if the present density of matter in baryonic content is more than a certain area value, here you see, then there is no deuterium produced by the universe. So the model that Gamow was proposing, the Big Bang model, in which light nuclei are produced in the early stages, it was necessary to have the situation that in order to be on a positive side for this particular nucleus, helium deuterium nucleus, you need to restrict the baryon density of the universe today. So this we will come to shortly. Then in 1948, two of Gamow's colleagues, Alfer and Hermann, they wrote a paper in Nature in which they predicted that there should be a relic cool radiation background today, and they speculated that its temperature will be around 5K. They did not calculate it, but they expected it around that. And standard cosmology predicts a thermal background today, but not its temperature. This is even today, after a lot of progress. It is still a given thing, 2.7K, but not deducible. So evidence for such a background already existed by observations of Mackellar in 1941. So you can ask this question. I many times have said that there is a TV show which says who wants to be a millionaire, and there somebody is asked to answer questions of a practical nature or information aspect. And one of the questions I said could be, so who discovered microwave background? And the answer could be Mackellar, Gamow, and Alfer and Hermann. So these could be given, and nobody would think of Mackellar, but because this happened in 1941, and 41 was wartime period, and so not many astronomers got information about Mackellar's finding it through spectroscopic means. So he remained unsung for a long time, until recently. So the best curve that you see here is the cosmic background spectrum at different wavelengths, and the curve that you get is very good fit to the black body curve of 2.7K. So this is a very strong argument in favor of the hot universe that we talked about little while ago. So one could say the observed facts are seen to confirm a speculation about the very early universe. So the last scattering surface, however, places a limit on how far or how early a universe can we observe. Now, if you look at this light cone picture, this is the cone that is drawn. Sorry. This present epoch, you draw the past light cone, and you see that in this region, in this period, local galaxies are seen, then distant galaxies are seen, then you further out, quasars are seen, largest redshifts, and then you have surface of last scattering, which means that if you go on this side, the light is, the particles are able to, that means basically hydrogen. The electrons and protons are free particles on this side, and they can scatter radiation. So if radiation is scattered, you cannot see things clearly on this side. So this is what you call the surface of last scattering, redshift of around 1,000. So this is a limitation on our observing the universe. So if you want to go to the big, the very early stages, very close to Big Bang, you find that you cannot do it howsoever good your telescopes are. Because once you are on this side, below the bottom slab in this picture, you find that you cannot see what is going on. So the very early universe, that means going very close to that point, the success of primordial nucleosynthesis and microwave backgrounds inspired cosmologists to venture closer to Big Bang, starting a new subject, the astroparticle physics. So extrapolation of physics to very high energies leads to time-energy relationship, which looks like this is the time-temperature relationship using standard cosmology. Now, Gamow's work on nucleosynthesis was around the MeV range. You see here T written as M in units of MeV. And unification of weak and electromagnetic interaction happens around 80 GeV. Grand unification may occur around 10 to the 16 GeV. And quantum gravity effects occur at 10 to the 19 GeV. So you can see that this particular equation tells you about the very early universe at different epochs. So these energies occurred at various epochs at the very early universe. So one could say that the astroparticle physics came out of very high energy particle physics plus very early universe. That is, you put cosmology at very early and then have this particular relationship. So this is the kind of thing the CERN has, a very high energy particle experiment. And one could say that particle physicists, when they formed this alliance, astroparticle physics, the particle physicists felt that since the Big Bang is established and secure as a theory of cosmology, let me try my speculations of very high energy particle physics in this background. So particle physicists felt that cosmologists seem to know about the state of the universe very well. So let us use their ideas and make our theory advance, because we can't produce energies of that kind which the universe is able to produce. So that was one thing. On the other hand, cosmologists said that since particle physicists know what they are talking about, let me apply their theories to test my speculations of the very early universe. So cosmologists felt that particle physicists are on very strong ground, and they are able to, therefore, supply the basis for what Big Bang cosmologists want to study. So the very early universe is a poor man's high energy accelerator, as is often said. And we can say that one of the ideas from astroparticle physics, popular among cosmologists, is of inflation. This occurred at the grand unified theory epoch, when the grand unified theory split into strong and weak interactions. This phase transition is supposed to have caused a fast expansion, inflation of the universe. Now, when then we come to theory and speculation, the last scattering surface prevents us from directly observing the state of the universe at early epoch. This is what I had shown you earlier. And if not directly observable, one can study those early epochs with a well-tested theory, like Gamow's nucleosynthesis. Now, in Gamow's nucleosynthesis, nuclear physics was well known, well understood, and one could do the calculation with confidence. But we do not have any well-tested theory within energies of the order of 1,000 to 10 to the 16 GeV. And so ideas like inflation represent speculations rather than well-founded scientific theories. This is the point I want to make. So one can ask, can two speculations together add up to a fact? Because we have got speculation on high energy physics and speculation on cosmology. So we are merging together to have the astroparticle physics. So one could say, yes, in astroparticle physics, this happens. Examples of two speculations: if there are grand unified theories, then there will be magnetic monopoles with relic density abnormally high. If there is inflation also, then these monopoles are washed away. So from a null observation, that is no observation of monopoles seen today, one is apparently able to confirm two speculations, namely grand unified theory operated in the very early universe, and inflation took place in the very early epochs. Now you see that you are needing one to supplement the other. Together they would survive, but by themselves they cannot. And you have these speculations. So one could say that one is in a way putting in epicycles. Now when I use the word epicycle, many standard cosmologists get very angry, because the epicycle is somehow linked in public mind with what the Greeks did in the old times before heliocentric theory got its proper setting. So You have here Friedman, Robertson, Walker universe. Then you've got an how much lambda you want to put in, omega lambda. Then n-body simulations, how you want to order them. Then there is how much dark matter is present. How much biasing is there between dark matter and bright matter. Inflation, which inflation? Because there is no unique theory of inflation. And quantum fluctuations at the end. So one could say the epicycle of non-baryonic dark matter, that is, astronomical evidence exists for dark matter that exceeds what is visible, but by how much? See, if you take all the dark matter in the universe, you run up into a density which is higher than what was needed to produce, at that kind of density, no deuterium would be produced. You remember I mentioned deuterium in relation to nuclei. So simplest alternative known to astrophysicists is black holes, brown dwarf, Jupiters, or other non-shining matter, but made of neutrons and protons as in the visible case. This was the standard answer if you had something which is dark. But now you can't give that answer because if you exceed the nuclear density, then you run into problem. So there is the baryonic option that you have to give up, and therefore you say if dark matter turned out to be wholly baryonic, it will pose problems for Big Bang. That is, too little primordial deuterium. Large scale structure would create too large fluctuations today in the radiation background. So there are problems having dark matter very baryonic. So the alternatives available are, since these conditions exist, contradictions exist, we need to revise our standard Big Bang model. So we believe the model to be true and are willing to modify our view of what dark matter is made of, even if it has no other direct observational support. As yet, there is no direct astronomical or laboratory evidence for non-baryonic dark matter. Yet it is asserted that it exists in far greater quantity than the normal baryonic matter. So this is the situation. So one is reminded of this Hans Andersen story, The Emperor's New Clothes, which, in case you don't know the story, it is like this, that there was a king who was fond of putting on different clothes, different fashions, and people used to come and bring a lot of new clothes for him. So some crooks decided to cash in on this, and they came and said to the king, here is new clothes for you. If you wear it and other people don't see it, then those people are sinners. Only the people who don't commit any sin, they will be able to see these clothes. So he said, that way you can tell which of your courtiers are good and which are not. So king was very happy. He bought a big fund, and they said they will make it to measure and bring it. When they brought it, they said, now here is the clothes, and they put it. He couldn't see that they had put on any clothes, but he had to accept what, because otherwise it would prove to be he himself was a sinner. So he praised, and then the courtiers came and looked at the naked king, and they all praised, saying, what nice dress. Then they said, why don't you go around in the town and let everybody see? So he went around the town and let everybody see. And here you see a king, a small child standing there, And everybody else was saying, what nice clothes, because they didn't want to be called sinners. But this little boy or girl, they was not worried about being called bad or good. So she suddenly asked her mother, why is the king not wearing any clothes? So this is the situation, that you are having new clothes with non-baryonic dark matter, which everybody has to accept, although nobody has yet seen it. But this is one thing. And epicycle of cold dark matter. What type of non-baryonic dark matter? So one could say no example of that kind of matter is seen yet. And then there is the epicycle of cosmological constant, which Einstein had put in, then he had taken it out. But recall that earlier Big Bang theorists discouraged the use of lambda and had concluded that the universe is decelerating. Observations of distant supernovae cannot be explained unless the universe is accelerating. So the cosmological constant was recalled and accorded the place of honor because it was needed. So, however, it soon became clear that this simple addition made by Einstein was not enough. It is necessary to have a variable lambda because the magnitude of this constant must drop by a factor as high as 10 to the power 108 since the early moments after the Big Bang when inflation was called for. So how to achieve it? So this feature is explained by saying that there is dark energy in the universe, which is as yet not integrated in the real physics. So the modern picture seems based on a large number of speculative assumptions, none of which is independently tested, whether as experimentally tested physics or observationally tested astronomy. So the subject needs an entirely different approach in which cosmology is seen as a natural extension of extragalactic astronomy. So here is what Fred Hoyle had to say back in 1970. He said that, I think it is very unlikely that a creature evolving on this planet, the human being, is likely to possess a brain that is fully capable of understanding physics in its totality. I think this is inherently improbable in the first place, but even if it should be so, it is surely wildly improbable that this situation should have just been reached in the year 1970. Because in 1970, people were saying very categorically that we know what the Big Bang universe is like. So this was prior to inflation, grand unified theory, non-baryonic dark matter, lambda, and CMBR, anisotropies. None of these were known, and these came afterwards. So one should not feel that, but this is equivalent to what I was saying, that each culture felt that they had the final answer, although it was not the situation. So a plea to cosmologists, please treat the subject as open with room for alternative ideas. The cosmologists today are like a flock of geese. You see here geese going in, say they are all following a certain set of geese. And Jeffrey Burbidge, who got this picture somewhere, he used to say that he can name some of the leading geese who are taking cosmology this way. So I would suggest that when you are studying a cosmology, to keep a kind of open mind and allow for some alternatives because of the importance of the issue. This problem you are trying to solve is very, very deep. And it is not easy to say that we have solved it completely today. Thank you very much. think I will sit down in case there are any questions I'll answer.
So the research that used to happen like 2 centuries ago, let's say, is very different than what is happening right now, because there is a collective effort that is being, there in the research community. So the ideas that there, the open ideas that there were like a century ago, let's say, or 2 centuries ago, wouldn't be as open that as they are right now. So what do you think about that? I mean, I agree with you that clearly that there is always some open space and there is no dead end.
What is this?
Can you summarize the question in a short, compact way?
Okay.
Can you give a compact question?
A compact question would be, so aren't there dead ends to the physics that like that is being done right now? Are there any conclusive answers that we have, like, because the
I'm not sure I can.
Okay.
So what is that? I mean, he can't hear well. So I need to tell the question to him. If I don't understand the question well, it's difficult for me to translate the question.
The talk started with the idea that there are so many. Think we understand something, but there is some substantial changes. But that used to happen in the time when the physics was like a close community. But now it's almost like a collective effort, and it's very different from what it used to be at that time.
So at least my interpretation is that earlier when you said the changes used to happen,
there is some possibility.
You think that there are definitive ideas, but then the ideas would change. It used to be a small, close community,
mm-hmm.
and now it is a much bigger, open community.
Mm-hmm.
And
well,
so I didn't know the question.
Yeah,
that's the comment he made. So
see, I should make one comment that when people say at each epoch they have the right answer, and that happens to be different from what the previous thinks. So when this is pointed out to them, they say that those people did not have enough astronomy, my astronomy is better. So some of the things that they made mistakes, which we do not make any longer. But the point is that even then, why are you certain your astronomy is certainly better astronomy than what previously was done, but you cannot be certain that you are right. One has to allow for mistakes.
Excuse me, sir. So my question was...
There is one... he was asking.
So my question was, how are we supposed to know that we are going in the right way, like in the current astro particle physics?
How are we supposed to know that we are going the right way? Yeah, how are we supposed to know that we are going the right way?
How are we supposed to know that we are going the right way? Well, the thing is, if you are not required to make too many extra assumptions. Now, you remember I showed the Pythagorean model where they had to first assume the counter Earth and then show that you have to face away from it. So this is an example when you have to produce more and more extra assumptions to prop up a theory, then it is a sign that you are not in the right track. That is how I would put it. And that is why I showed all that circle upon circle, that epicycle, to so many things are needed before you get the right answer. But that is so many assumptions.
Hello, Dr. Narlikar. My question is regarding, somebody had stated that the speed of light has never been constant over the, since the creation of the universe. Has the speed of light always been 10 to the power 8 meters per second, or has that ever changed?
Has the speed of light been constant, or has it changed?
Some people argue that speed of light has changed from old times to modern times, and there is some spectroscopic evidence also quoted for this. But I don't think at the moment we have a very clear-cut sign that velocity of light has changed or is changing. But the alternative, if you assume it is changing, that is the changes can be in many different ways. So it becomes a very untestable theory.
Sir, I had a question that Penrose proposed another theorem, that conformal cyclic cosmology. Do you think that this has some potential?
Penrose's theory of conformal cyclic cosmology, does it have any potential?
Oscillatory.
Yeah.
Well, there have been cosmological theories in which the universe oscillates. Now, myself, I have been associated with Fred Hoyle and Jeffrey Burbidge in what we call quasi-steady-state cosmology, in which the universe oscillates and also has a long-term expansion. And we showed that we can explain all the available data today in terms of this model. I think some different versions of oscillation are produced by other people using different physics, basic physics. So these possibilities seems attractive, provided we know how to fit it into observational constraints. If you can explain all the observations, it's well and good.
I ask then one more small question. Okay. Some papers and others I have seen that in Schwarzschild solution, R equals to zero is a real singularity or not. Some people argue against it, that it is not a real singularity, it is just a coordinate singularity. Can you say something about that?
In the Schwarzschild black hole solution, R equal to zero, is it a real singularity or not?
Is it
a real singularity or not?
You mean R equal to zero in...
R equals to zero in center.
Yeah.
Some Abhash Mitra wrote a paper that it is just a coordinate transformation singularity like Schwarzschild radiation.
I think you have a lot of relativists. You should ask them what they think. But the point is that you have to... You can look upon it in the following way. Instead of looking at the end point where you've got Schwarzschild solution, you have a shrinking matter, to have a dust ball which is shrinking, and at the end it will reach infinite density, and that will be a singular state. So how you reach to that point is also important. This way at least you can tell you. But if you simply say, I've got this Schwarzschild solution, how it came about is important.